Hello and welcome to Pursuit a Perfect System. My name is Terry Ellis, I'm an audio reviewer, and this is my video coverage for the Munich High-End Show 2019. I'd like to thank my show coverage sponsors. Melco, GIK Acoustics, Tellurium Q. I have created lots of videos as part of a coverage for the high-end show, and you'll find other videos like this in my channel. I hope you enjoy this video. If you do, hit that like button, make sure you've subscribed to the channel, and I'll be seeing you all soon.
High fidelity audio. This would be approximately the mid-50s, where we finally broke through and had electronics and loudspeakers capable of reproducing what was considered the full spectrum of frequencies a human could hear or feel. Approximately 20 hertz to 20,000 kilohertz. And through that first period, and through that milestone of achievement in electronics and loudspeaker technology, until I started my first shop as a technician in approximately 1977, the speaker cable that everyone knew was this. It's a lamp cord. In America, this would be considered about approximately 22 gauge. In the rest of the world, this would be considered approximately 1 square millimeter. One side is tin, so you know the polarity. The other side is a very cheap electrical grade copper. I bought this 6 months ago. It's already starting to tarnish. This sounds dreadful. I wouldn't let my worst enemy use this if I had anything to do with it. It is not acceptable for reproducing high-resolution audio. Yet, it has some nice features. It's flexible, it's very affordable, and the truth of the matter is that even in 2019, even today, there's electrical engineers who appear on forums regularly, certain that cables are all nonsense, and certainly expensive cables are a complete waste of your money and investment, and the idea that this ought to be fine. You got a really big amplifier, fairly inefficient speaker, maybe we'll move up to 2 or 3 millimeter, maybe we'll move up to a 16 gauge lamp cord. That ought to do you just fine. And the truth of the matter is that they're right. They're right. If you look at the frequency response of this, the way they're going to measure it, the way it's traditionally been measured, it's fine. If you look at the phase shift of this, it's fine. If you look at the distortion of this, it's fine. If you look at the current carrying capacity of this, it's mostly fine. Measured the way it was traditionally done. Here's the problem with science. I'm a person who has spent my life with science and numbers, but they're only as good as the investigation, the work you've done. Science evolves, and if you do not measure the right things, you won't see some of the problems. If you don't know the problems, you can't fix them. This wire is terrible. Why? Well, because even though it measures well in traditional pedagogy, the fact of the matter is that it measures well when you're looking at very loud levels. If we look at the ceiling as our loudest level, and that's 20 decibels or plus 20 decibels above zero, way up there, at least 12 to 20 volts, that's going to do very, very well. It's not going to have a problem. But the thing is that real music and real reproduction is also about simultaneously reproducing signals that are in this middle range, 60 to 80 decibels below that. And it's most critically also, particularly at a show like this, about reproducing signals that are down here, where it's 80 decibels below zero, 100 decibels below zero, or even further, all the way down to the floor. We can reproduce, we can capture in a studio today, 130 decibels of dynamic range, easily. So the problem is that you have to measure all of those simultaneously. If you do that, what you'll start to see is that there's great distortions in these cables. There's all kinds of losses in these cables, and noise from our atmosphere can be induced into these cables just as they can be induced into modern sensitive electronics, and you can lose information. One of the problems that we've also had as cable engineers is that times change, not just in terms of the styles or music or political landscape, but just our environment. Because, for example, if we take a look at speaker from cable from, say, the beginning of the audiophile period of cable design, this was probably one of the first really well-known cables, Monster Cable. This is from 1979. Approximately 257 strands, rope lay construction, very soft durometer PVC. Every cable manufacturer has gone way past this at this point. But again, be fair, it's 40 years ago. And when I heard this at age approximately 17 for the first time, it eclipsed what I'd been using before so badly. This was a godsend. It was a revelation. But in terms of noise, this has no shield. This has nothing about it that would reduce radio-induced frequencies. And is it because the engineers were incompetent that created this? No. Because the environment in those days, again, this is the late 70s going on into the 80s, all you had was the radio I knew as a child, and most of us knew when it was your child, or possibly our parents. AM radio, FM radio, terrestrial television, shortwave. Those frequencies could be addressed easily with an interconnect with a simple shield, a fine metal chassis to keep those induced radio frequencies out of the signal, to keep them from getting distorted, to keep them from masking the content. That was enough. And what came out of a power amplifier that went to a speaker, the loudspeaker cable, was so high in amplitude, it was considered above the noise floor. Don't worry about shielding, you won't need it. But times have changed. Today, we have a new generation of radio frequencies we have to concern ourselves with. We have cellular towers. We depend on that now. We have Bluetooth. We have Wi-Fi. We have a larger proliferation of satellites than any time before. And why is that important? It's not just because there's more radio frequencies to induce themselves into these sensitive electronics and cables. The problem is that these frequencies of these radio waves are higher. When frequencies are higher, the waveform is smaller. This is important. Let's say, we're going to talk about sine waves for a moment. I'm an engineer, I love this stuff. So, okay, if I'm playing an imaginary double bass, and I'm holding the neck up here, and it's this big body here with the four strings coming down, and I have my other hand by the bridge, and I pluck the low E string, boom, the sine wave or sine tone is so large, it will go from where I'm standing practically back to the window. It's a little shorter than that, but it's close to that. It's a big sine tone, big waveform. But if I go up to some of the highest frequencies we can hear, let's say I play a triangle. Ding! The upper partial or harmonic from that instrument will be so high, it'll get close to the highest frequency we supposedly can hear, approximately 20,000 hertz. That sine wave, it's only about 18 millimeters. If we look at the carrier frequency to Bluetooth, that's 2.4 gigahertz. That means the sine tone, when that hits this chassis or hits these cables, the sine tone is so small, I could stack 200 of them end to end and fit them on the edge of this paper. So with these new radio frequencies, this is no longer enough. A conventional shield is not enough, and a speaker cable that's not dealing with shielding and serious noise dissipation is not going to cut it anymore. Because something that small, it's going to get into everything. It's going to be a mess. A metal chassis is not enough. It's going to passively couple straight in. This chassis to a frequency that high is an antenna. Why do I care about this so much? Why am I exercised by this noise? Not because I'm worried about shh coming through or believing that I'm going to hear the local terrestrial radio station breaking through. These electronics are too good. the engineers were too good. That's never going to happen. No, it's the noise that's going to be created and the way it's going to affect the signal. You see, you have to understand with good audio and great music what we're listening to. Why can we hear the difference between a spinet or an upright piano, jing, and a 9 foot, approximately 3 meter Hamburg Grand Steinway? Jing. I can promise you, and I can prove this with spectrum analysis. If I play, say, an F sharp minor 7 chord here, jing, and one here, jing, and I adjust for volume, they're gonna look identical. But we can all hear the difference, and most of us are gonna prefer this piano over here. What's the difference? It's the harmonic structure that follows the fundamental. They're vastly different between these two, and our ears go to that immediately. We cherish that. So do the musicians. It's what part of what they're using to express their emotion and to get their content, to get their message across to us. It's magic. But the thing is that those harmonics, as well as the air around the instruments, as well as the stage width, the stage depth, the extreme highs, the fast transients, all of that tends to be very low in signal level. And the lower in signal level it gets at a time in history where noise is growing up from the ground higher and higher and higher, it's going to mask the signal. We don't want this. We want this. It's as if I put a veil or a woolen blanket in front of this Bowers and Wilkins 800, and I don't want this. I want this. But as I've said with power before, if I'm going to dissipate noise, if I'm going to try to funnel it away, if I'm going to try to take it from the things that are critical, like this and this amplifier, and turn it into heat, into loss, I have to absolutely make sure that I do this across all 12 octaves of induced radio frequencies, and I have to do it evenly, consistently, what an engineer would call linearly. I can't try to get rid of noise where I only get rid of half the veil on the tweeter and a third of the mid-range driver and unveil the woofers. That's not good enough. I want to get rid of it all. And if I don't, I'm going to make a mess of that harmonic structure. It's going to be inconsistent with frequency. It's going to be inconsistent with volume level. And since music, the volume is ever moving and changing, even if you have the dial fixed, that's going to be a problem. It's inaccurate. That's not the musician's intent. We have to do better. However, even though AudioQuest and many other manufacturers have attempted to do certain technologies, certain efforts in this direction, they've really rarely been linear. And if you look at this as a problem, it's pretty easy to understand why. You can't put an integrated circuit chip in part of a cable and expect the good work that it does here to affect those very small waveforms here, 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 and here. You can't put a box or rope at the end of your cable with very, very fine circuitry that's causing many, many, many benefits, including sometimes noise reduction or noise dissipation, and expect it to be over here and affect everything down there. If it's going to be linear, any effect that you do to get rid of noise has to be across the entire surface. That's much more challenging, but it's absolutely vital because, again, I don't want this, I want this. There's a second problem that's been vexing every cable designer, including AudioQuest, for decades, and that's something called characteristic impedance. It's what makes every speaker cable a sponge where transient current is concerned. Now, a power amplifier, justifiably so, you know, like I'm justifiably stated, is delivering great amounts of power, which includes voltage and current, into the loudspeaker. The problem that you're going to have is simply that every cable has a defined impedance. If you have an old-fashioned aerial on a roof, there's a coaxial cable that comes down, that comes to your television or comes to your, you know, like a satellite box or whatever. It has a number printed on it. It's likely something along the lines of 75 ohms. Now, does that mean that there's 75 ohms of resistance in the cable? No. It means that the cable was designed in such a way to where if it sees a source like this Mola Mola power amplifier, and a load represented by this Bowers and Wilkins 800, if they're both 75 ohms and I build a cable at 75 ohms, all of these problems with noise, current, and distortion plummet. It's called the transmission line. It works beautifully. It's incredible. This technology goes back to the 1920s. It's how we were able to do transcontinental communication without it being any, nothing but echoes and distortion. So let's make a transmission line for the speaker cable. Great, except it won't work. And here's why. There is no such thing as any loudspeaker that is always consistently 8 ohms, 4 ohms, or 6 ohms. They're just, or even 16 ohms. They're just not. They vary, and they vary with not only frequency, but they vary with drive level. To make matters even worse, what comes out of a power amplifier is anywhere near 4, 6, or 8 ohms. It's a fraction of an ohm. And actually, for current transfer, it's kind of a good thing that it is, because if it was anywhere around 4, 6, or 8 ohms, you would have, you'd lose half your power, and your damping factor would be zero, which means your woofers are no longer controlled. They're flopping in the breeze. It'd be the worst sounding one note bass you ever heard. Completely leaden, no one would ever accept it. So everybody that's designed loudspeakers has always had a defined characteristic impedance. It's never labeled. Most people don't even measure it. Most people don't even look. You just accept that it's there. Some people aren't even aware that this is an issue, but believe you me, it is. Because it means that the fast currents that happen every time there is a musical attack, such as a snare drum, bam! Or every time there's a sforzando attack on a piano, ding! Or every time there's a plectrum of a guitar, ding! In milliseconds, you have a peak-to-peak voltage swing. You have a lot of fast transient current coming out of the amplifier, boom! And it's got to make it to the loudspeaker unencumbered. If you have a characteristic impedance, it's like a sponge. And instead of boom, you have it's rounding it off. It's slowing it down. We don't want that. But how do we deal with this? Get rid of the characteristic impedance entirely. This is what we've done with our new Zero technology. The Zero technology takes the defined characteristic impedance, usually defined by the relationship geometrically between high and low, and what's called the insulation or dielectric constant. We've gotten rid of the dielectric constant. Therefore, we've gotten rid of that problem. Now, I'm an engineer. I can go on and on, but I'm not going to do that. It's not fair to you. It's muggy. It's hot. It's a long show. And also, what kind of credibility do I have? Yeah, I'm an engineer, but the fact of the matter is that everybody that's ever come up with a product has got a story to tell about it. And the thing of it is that you don't know if it's true. I wouldn't believe you if I were you either. Don't believe me. Never believe somebody like me. Prove it to yourself. That's what we're going to do for the rest of the seminar. We're going to listen to four different cables and see if we can hear this ourselves. We're going to start by taking a trip back to 1979. We're going to start with Monster Cable Bywire. Then we're going to go to what many would have considered, conservatively, one of the 10 or 12 best speaker cables, like made in the last 10 years. That would be the AudioQuest Wild single bywire. This is perfect surface silver. It has a number of our technologies that our founder invented. It's a tremendous cable. Up to a year ago when it was still available, this was at 3 meter lengths over 20,000 euros. It's incredible technology. And you'll get to hear how not only AudioQuest, but in a broader sense, the cable industry at large matured over those 30 years and how far we went. Then after that, what we're going to do is we're going to listen to these new technologies I'm talking about, getting rid of the characteristic impedance, dealing with noise linearly and effectively. And that's going to be done first with the top of our Folk Hero series. That would be the William Tell Bywire. That speaker cable is less than a quarter of the price, considerably less than a quarter of the price of the Wild, and it's going to destroy. After that, we're going to go to the pinnacle of our new and penultimate Mythical Creatures speaker cable series, the Dragon. Similar technology, better conductors, perfect surface silver, even superior insulation or dielectric material. We're going to listen to the same cut, same volume each time. This cut is from Americana roots and blues musician from America, Ryan Cooder. It's his new one, Prodigal Son. Again, same volume each time. Let's listen for ourselves. But the entire speaker cable profession or market did a lot of engineering, did a lot of homework, and matured greatly since those years, over 40 years ago. The next one is, you know, like a design that goes back to our founder, Bill Lowe, from approximately 8 to 10 years ago, I believe. I could be slightly wrong about that, but it's close. And this, up to a year ago, would have been one of the two best cables we knew how to make. And it's a great cable. Very low in distortion, great bandwidth. So,
just the wild.
That's the wild. Wild single bi-wire. Yeah. So let's listen to the same thing, same volume.
We're just about ready to go.
I got a Bible in my home. and it's nobody's fault but mine.
We learned a bit, you know, like over those years. Yeah, less distortion, wider sound stage, deeper sound stage, just more of everything. You know, we've always talked before about what's the ultimate speaker cable? No speaker cable. By that I don't mean wireless. But the ideal would be if I could take the amplifier, scoot it up against the back of the speaker, and have a speaker cable that's approximately a centimeter long. That's always been our standard. Some believe in ideal lengths of cable. We do not. No. You know, that the less you can get away with, the better off you are going to be. That's still true today, but what if we could minimize those losses through longer lengths? And that's what we've been working on. So the next one we're going to listen to has the new technologies. The zero technology, getting rid of the characteristic impedance. Making sure that we're getting rid of and dissipating far more noise and doing so linearly at all induced frequencies.
Ready to do that? Just seconds.
When did the William Tell come in?
The William Tell and the Dragon that we'll be listening to after that have both been released within the last 5 to 6 months. These are all very, very, very good. So we've lowered the DC resistance, better power transfer to the loudspeaker, slightly refined and larger insulation or dielectric material, but otherwise, same material. But just with the conductor alone, a considerable step up in sound quality, but also with a addition in price. You know, the last thing that we heard, it does all the audiophile superlatives that people talk about, but one of the things that, you know, that a lot of people notice is that, did you turn the volume up? I've literally had electrical engineers in some of the seminars that I've done when I do things like this and I make these changes, and they're certain that we're up to something. They're certain I've got something up my sleeve, and they've got their, you know, like app program on their smartphone, and they're pushing it out with their microphone. Aha, it's up 4 decibels. Then, you know, like they must have goosed, you know, like the volume somewhere. The volume knob on the Mola Mola is right there. I haven't touched it. I don't need to, because the transients are no longer compressed. Yes, the RMS level has not changed one iota, but the peak-to-peak transients are no longer being compressed. So, in effect, it is louder. Here's the last one. Yes, it works. So the thing is, though, is that, as I said much earlier, this is foundation level technology, whether it's our new line and new technologies for speaker cables, power, everything that we do. I fully recognize that it's not going to get the mind share and the eye-catching attention of a turntable, or a good DAC, a good power amplifier, or a loudspeaker. That's never going to happen. I've come to peace with the fact that I'm spending my life making what most people are going to consider accessories, which is sort of a nice, you know, like way of talking about this as if it's almost an afterthought. You know, I'm just sort of like Johnny Appleseed, you know, like running around, you know, like the world. Here's some seeds, plant and grow, you know, like have your accessory. But the fact of the matter is that no, again, the system is one. I'm not saying don't get the best loudspeaker you can get. This is so, so important. Or the best, you know, like a power amplifier, or the best source component. Upgrade when you can. Give your system some flowers. It's a wonderful thing to do. But understand, if you don't get the foundation level proper, if it's ignored, you'll be getting more with the signal that's left over. Because once you lose signal, once you lose information, it's gone. It's gone forever. Everything counts. This is not an accessory. It's a necessity. Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.